All right, and a very, very, very good evening to each one of you. Thank you, everybody, for joining in for yet another session with the five-day series with Prem Raj. We have today with us Mr. Bharat Kumar, and we are extremely happy to have him here and gain some great experience that he has. He's a seasoned banker who has so much information that he's going to share with us today. And we are completely looking forward to it. And, you know, there were some people who joined much before the time also. That's the kind of excitement that we have, Bharat Kumar ji. And we are looking forward for this session. My name is Jaya Obhan, and I'm the founder of Power Up. Power Up is a business community which has entrepreneurs who are like-minded, and we come together for a lot of business opportunities, a lot of marketing that we do for ourselves and for each other, a lot of business being generated into this group, and a lot of learning. And because this group is compiled of such brilliant members, and some of them being here also, I'm so proud of being part of this group today. And with that, let me introduce to you Prem Raj ji before I hand it over to him. KV Prem Raj is an author and futurist speaker on leadership and management. He has spent 37 years in banking with experience in private and public sector. He was also the CEO of the BPO arm of a leading private sector bank. Prem Raj is the co-author of 3 books. All 3 books hit the number one spot on Amazon best-selling list. Views expressed by Prem Raj have been published in Economic Times, Business Standard, Financial Express, Indian Express, Mumbai Mirror, and other periodicals. He hails from Mumbai and resides with his wife, son, daughter-in-law, mother-in-law, and pet cat-in-law. That's like a great family to have in. I will now hand it over to you, Prem Raj ji, and we are completely looking forward to this session. There you go.
Thank you, Jaya. Thanks for that kind introduction. We have today with a career banker with close to 40 years of banking experience. He had a checkered career in Bank of Maharashtra, handling a slew of challenging assignments across the country. During the course of his working life, he has been awarded numerous rewards for his outstanding work. Post-retirement as general manager, he is based out of Ahmedabad, from where he is talking to us today. Let us know more about him directly from him. Welcome to the show, Mr. S. Bharat Kumar.
Thank you, Prem Raj. Thank you, Jaya Obhan, for giving me a sumptuous praise. And I'm really very happy that you chose me to converse. That itself gives me a goose pimples to me, in the sense that you are a number one author. I wrote no books, much less I am less smart than you. So you, despite that handicap, you call me, itself makes me extremely happy, and I am thankful to you, and I am thankful to the Power Up and the team. I have been watching your lecture series for the few days, and I find that it has been very impressive. And few days I am listening to the way the questions are being posed to the people opposing to the speaker. I am really very impressed with the way the activity has happened.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Yeah, so you are being very kind and humble. You are a colossus as far as banking is concerned. I have known you for the last 30 odd years.
Thank you.
So let's get cracking. Can you please share some highlights of a nearly 4 decades in the banking industry?
Yeah, I have joined the Bank of Maharashtra. Before that, I was in Indian Bank, maybe around nearly 40 years, like you rightly said. And in my career, few incidences are there. Cutting short, I don't want to praise my own self, but few of them, maybe the youngsters who are following this conversation, maybe it may be of some help to them. One of them was that, number one was where we showed in Bank of Maharashtra a uniqueness in those days. Say it was in 1985, when in those days there was no NPA identification under prudential norms, nor were there any recovery agency appointments. In those days, any bad debts have to be recovered only by the manager himself. So it so happened that it was the year 1985 when there was the communal riots in Ahmedabad in 84. And thereafter, what happened? The loans which were granted by my predecessor in 82, they were getting 3 years and they became bad debts, especially in all transport operator loans, rickshaws and three-wheelers and four-wheelers. And it was a huge sum of 30, 40 lakhs in those days, which is a handsome sum. And the documents were getting time-barred within a period of 3 years. So it was in 85, all the documents were getting time-barred in the month of August. And it so happened that it was not possible atmosphere due to communal riots to personally meet those borrowers and renew them, because all these borrowers, they sold that particular, all these vehicles to some other sector segment of people by taking money out of the banking arena. So they got their own margin back. So only the entire money of bank borrowing was stuck up 100%. So it was at this juncture, I joined as a manager at a branch at Dineshall, Ashram Road. I did not know what to do, but it was at that point of time. I had gone to took the help of some customer, and he has suggested a way out for me. Sir, if at all we catch all those rickshaws and these trucks, possibly we can recover the money. There is no other way possibility to go and meet the person to whose possession the vehicles are there. So everyone should come to the ST bus stand or railway station or Accra in Accra. So let's do like that. So with the help of the customer, at the cost of 250 rupees per vehicle, I appointed somebody, which was unique in the first occasion, and it was for lodging it in a godown. It was 100 rupees, 90 rupees per receipt. So by that method, within a period of 30 days, I had caught all the vehicles under the power of attorney. That is, we call it as a F-66 in Bank of Maharashtra. That power of the executed by the borrowers. In that power, I exercised and got all the vehicle and put it in the godown, and I had recovered all the money. This was one important experience I got in 85. My action was not confirmed by my immediate divisional manager at that time, but I referred it to the chief law officer of the bank, who lauded me and praised me and said, "It's extraordinary courage has been given by a young boy. So we appreciate and confirm this action of doing this." And finally, all has happened. This is one incident I had happened. This is one part of innovation in those days. The second incident which was important was that one fine day after I was transferred from that branch and went to another branch, it so happened one day that branch was mezzanine floor was full of wooden. So due to short circuit, it got fire in the middle of the night maybe. So early in the morning around 7:30, some passerby got the telephone number of mine, being a predecessor of that branch. So he called me. So he said that your branch is burning. So I rushed there. By that time I reached there to that branch, it was around 8:15 in the morning. And by that time the firefighters have already come. Now in those days, there was not a mechanization day. So all were ledgers. There were about 64 ledgers were there in that branch. I thought nobody was allowed inside into the branch by the firefighters. They said that they were extinguishing the fire. Then I thought if fire does not eat all these, burn all those ledgers, this water by the fire extinguishers will burn. So I broke open from the side of the branch, because firefighters were not allowing me. I broke open one of the glass door, glass window, and I jumped inside the branch when the fire was burning. At that time, the mezzanine floor would have fallen down. Despite that, I threw all the ledgers out of the branch, all the ledgers single-handedly, and there was 3 crore worth of share certificates were inside the cupboard. With the stone, I broke open the cupboard also, inside Godrej cupboard, and took it and opened and took the 3 crore share that also I put outside. And finally, that's how, because of this aspect, that branch was saved. In 3 days, we could reopen that branch. Had we not done, suppose somebody has not updated the passbook, had he kept 100 rupees in the ledger, but in the passbook shows a balance of 10 lakhs, bank would have been liable to pay 10 lakhs to the person on the basis of the last passbook entry. That is the law which says. So by that method, we saved all the ledgers, and that is one great loyalty which I showed to the bank, which was beyond that. That's one thing I remember. The third incident which I had in my mind was our Madra branch was treated as a loss making. It was a loss making branch for 15 days, and management decided to close the branch. When they decided, it was one of the premier branch in Ahmedabad, number one branch. And when they decided to close it, then I wrote to the chairman. I said, I am ready to take a challenge to bring that branch in profit. So I was given an option by the branch, by the chairman, that to make that branch under a scheme, either to make it in profit in 2 years. So accordingly, I had worked in those days, maybe around 16 hours a day along with a team of officers. There were some 7-8 officers and all the staff I had taken. It was a union dominated branch. Despite all the things, I took all of them into confidence and we made the branch into break even. And second year we brought into profit 15 lakhs. And today that branch is making a crores of rupees as a profit even till this day. This happened in the year around 90s. These are three. And the fourth incident is which I can say is that I was posted in the one of the called as alternate business channel department in the head office. I was first deputy general manager posted there. Then where I had used, though I was not having any IT knowledge as such, like some of the GM IT sitting in the audience. Despite that, I learned from the scratch from him and from others and introduced a lot of new products. And with the help of Mr. Ramchandran, who is there, we could both could ensure that new products which is generating other income, whether it is insurance, whether it is car credit card or the gold coin, new gold coin or various government product, government taxes, everything we introduce. And that was also one of the important, thank you Payal, that was also one of the important occasion we have done. These are 3-4 incidents, there's such kind of lot of incidents there, but that will bore the audience. I hope that's enough. For the beginning.
Thank you. Thanks. This Ashram Road incident, when I was in Bhadra, I did hear about it. That had happened before I came to Ahmedabad. People were lauding your efforts for that.
Thank you so much, Kamraj.
Over the years, public sector banks have been losing market share to the new generation private sector banks. It is felt if this trend continues, public sector banks may soon become irrelevant. What do you think can be done to reverse this trend and make public sector banks relevant?
Actually, public sector banks losing a market share is a matter of truth. There is nothing going about it. In fact, it was a few years ago, some few decades ago, it was around 78-80% market share we were holding. Now it has come down to say 58% approximately. There are many reasons for that. See, when you lose a market share in a public sector bank, this cannot be construed only because of any negativism on the part of PSU banks. The point is, the core business, there are certain business strategies which has happened, in the like the extraordinary NPA has happened in the PSU banks, making them arresting their own ability to fund because of the capital restriction under Basel III. Besides that, so many private sector banks have come in the thing. See, basically, besides that, now you see, for example, if you see the latest data, even the small banks which has come, or they have taken a market share and growth rate of around 48%, which is not even new private sector bank are not having that kind of growth rate. See, the market share of business is now acquired by the small banks, the new private sector banks. Whereas the PSU banks are not in a position to elongate or increase their balance sheet. Their balance sheet gets squeezed. For example, if you see, take the case of Bank of Maharashtra. In the financial year of 2013, the Bank of Maharashtra achieved a business of 2 lakh crore deposit advances put together. Now today, even in the seven years, in any normal CAGR, it should have gone up to the level of 4 lakh crore of business nearly, if not less, even 3. Now, if you see, even today, the Bank of Maharashtra business is around 2.40 crores or 2.50 lakh crores. Not that they are unable to do anything, not that they don't want to fund. But the point is that in a PSU bank, they are now having a capital restriction. Now, today under Basel III, you are supposed to hold a 9% minimum capital, regulatory capital you are required to have, plus 2.5% of the CCR, which means that at any point of time you cannot go below 10.5% capital, which means that if you don't have adequate capital in your kitty, you cannot expand your advances. So when you cannot expand your advances, there is no point in mobilizing deposits and parking the surplus money at the low rate at the 3.5 or 4.5 in the bank rate at the elsewhere. So it's not profitable proposition. So it's a business decision by the respective PSU banks not to elongate or improve their increase their balance sheets on account of this NPA phenomena. Now I come to your question as such that whether the how the trend will be reversed. That question is actually that is what you are saying.
Yeah.
No, I tell you that basically if you see the between PSU bank and private sector banks, today in the customer's point of view, there are specific set of customers for PSU and there are specific other set of customers for private sector banks. There are customers with the young age profile, they prefer private sector banks. Yeah, customers with the middle age profile and old age profile go to the PSU banks. There are area dominate, different area profile, different geographical profile, different age profile, and different business pattern profile. So choosing a bank has got a different perceptions altogether. You cannot take it a one suit fits all theory cannot work here. But all the same, how the trend will be reversed? The only reversing is one. Today, the capital level of the bank has to go up. Today, all the PSU bank shares are at the low ebb. Even at the top PSU banks, even if they see six quarters or half year, they make profit. Still, their shares do not worth the compared to the say like HDFC Bank or ICICI Bank shares. You cannot compare the shares pricing of the PSU banks because they don't have that kind of inherent value due to their high NPA level, which is a legacy. So you have to, the only way forward is the NPA level has to be contained, reduced substantially. Number one. Number two is business aspect. Today, despite opening Janadhan bank accounts, maybe nearly 100 crore people in the country, I find that the penetration in the rural area is hardly 5 to 7% of business. In my opinion, exactly there is a huge business potential is available in rural area even today. Rural area do not have that kind of technology exposure what a urban area or metropolis area has got. They are not still ready on it. But there is an extraordinary scope is available and I feel PSU banks, including SBI and all the PSU banks are definitely more capable in making this transformation in the rural areas and disintermediation in rural area can happen in a lot way with the technology in future. So the process is on. The financial inclusion is already made some dent. Still, the last mile connectivity of the business conversion is yet to happen. But it is a process is happening. I tell you, the business, if at all the day it will happen, if nationalized banks could do this and they connect the rural activity like they have connected the metro or like even the private sector banks have done in the metros and urban areas, if nationalized bank, PSU bank can do in rural itself, I say even your Sensex will become not less than 51,000 to 60,000 points, it will be. That kind of potential it is there.
So let's hope that the Nationalized Bank cash in on the potential that the semi-urban and the rural areas offer. Yes, the future of India is in the rural areas.
It is there. It is with technology. The only difference is that without technology, it is useless. Yes, the entire technology has to be remodeled in a form the way the villagers will understand. That is the scheme that new tech company has to sit with the nationalized bank to find out what the rural needs. And that accordingly, they should be remodeled and redesigned technology. That is the only solution possible.
Yeah. So let's hope it happens.
Now I'm saying that you take the case of Amazon. I was told that Amazon is now started selling a substantial amount of goods, even in rural areas. Okay, now how Amazon could do I am not saying Amazon is a foreign company. It's not having as kind of legacy like Indian business. But still, they could start. They could appoint third party, and they could do a lot of third party business. And they quote that Amazon will do a billions of dollars business from Indian rural.
Yes.
Now, if you see the, if you see in certain cases like eChowpal, the ITC started eChowpal some time ago. Even CK Prahlad has pointed out about the eChowpal some 20, 30, 50 years ago. Even then, the eChowpal had not matured to the extent it was expected to have been matured. So rural has not been really concentrated upon in the way we want it to happen. That is the challenge for the PSU.
Yes. You rightly mentioned about the e-commerce firms. I was reading somewhere during the COVID, during the lockdown period, these e-commerce platforms has reached more than 99% of our pin code areas. So they have really, really reached into the rural pockets.
That's what the point is, exact point.
You touched upon NPA. Let's talk about that.
Yeah.
NPAs in public sector banks are on the rise. With the COVID-19 crisis, the problem is expected to worsen. Massive provision for bad debts have been made. For their capital needs, the banks are dependent on the government to bail them out. How long do you think this bailout will continue? Or do you think will the government be forced to let the weak banks die?
Yeah, right. Nice question, Ramraj.
One thing I tell you,
the weak bank to die question may not happen because out of today, today is the day of bank mergers and reducing the number of banks. Now they have already brought down the number of banks. Out of these 12 banks, which is brought down in PSU also, only 2 banks are having a bad numbers even today. Now, so that 2 banks are also in the process of going up. It's only a question of time. See what happened. Entire bank, if you see, the nationalized banks are hamstrung by one after other. The NPA is a phenomenon, you say, today which has happened. Now, NPA is not a thing of the handiwork of bank management.
I agree with you.
It's not the handiwork of any of the employees, lower level employees, maybe any executives. It's not. The NPA means it is the status of an economy in the India. NPA in a bank means it is the businessman, he has done to it. Now the question happened, why NPA has happening only with the PSU banks? Now one is a legacy issue. I can say about the legacy issue. If you see pre-nationalization, if you take the history of the Indian banking, say in the year 1964 or even 69, the PSU banks were nationalized by Indira Gandhi. But I am taking you to 1964. If you see in 1964, most of them were private sector banks. Even if you take the history, even in the First World War time, in the banking, all banks were in the hands, except the Imperial Bank, all banks were in the hands of the private sector. You will be surprised to know, whenever the First World War happened or the Second World War, great from every time, whenever such kind of thing happened, the biggest bank failure has happened only at that time. You see the history. The private sector is not actually called as a solution to the success of a bank. But in the past history, it was like that. Now, if you see on the floor of the parliament, in 1964, Morarji Desai himself has said when he was a finance minister that the bank funding do not happen in the rural area. They do not go to the needy priority sector areas of the country. Now, this is what the thing it was told by Morarji Desai in 1964. Prior to 1969 nationalization, if you see history, in 1967, the social control on banks was brought forward. First time in history, even in the private sector bank, the social controls were brought by way of an act of a parliament so that they were required to finance the priority sector. Subsequently, the bank nationalization happened not because they had a love for any employees. The bank nationalization happened not only because the pressure of the all the unions or anything, but mainly to change the country, to make the country to finance priority sector advances to all nooks and corners of the country they were made. And I tell you, there were strict opposition why even in those days, if you see subsequently even in Narasimhan committee, they themselves said that priority sector advances should not have target, and they should be removed from the target. They should maximum keep 10% at the most. That is what even Narasimhan committee has opined at that time. But prior to that, nationalization happened main purpose of priority sector. And I am telling you today, whatever may be the purpose for which the time the government had done, the priority sector has taken leaps and bounds in the country. Today, whatever India you are seeing, if any person at the nook and corner of a village in Nagaland, if he gets money, or a village near Kanyakumari or Kerala end, if anybody, Talasseri, somebody is getting a money, this priority sector funding was the handiwork of this nationalization. Now, can you tell me, this is not possible? Because you have to understand, at that time, the byproduct of this priority section was, when the priority sector advances were given, differential rate of interest at 4% were given. So, which means that I've been to the people, giving money to the people criteria for the thing has come into the mindset of the all bank employees. See, the PSU bank had this legacy issue. They thought that service to these people, giving money in the lower priority sector, became the issue. The top management of the bank also never gave profitability consideration. Can you imagine till the 2012 or 11, never bothered about other income of the bank. Bank had to wait from 69 to 2012. That is about 40 years, more than 43 years to wait for other income. Till then, bank were relying only on the interest income, that too on this kind of thing. So this is a legacy we have to understand. Now this legacy resulted in account becoming NPA. If you see the NPA status, forget about the nationalization, even at the year 1998-99 or even till the 2000, when the time the LPG, that is liberalization, globalization and the privatization came into being in the country, till then the NPA level was 15.7% of the total advances. It's not that NPA has never been less, but from 1999 to 2011, if you see in 2011-12, the NPA level has come down to 3%, approximately 3.2 or something. The NPA level came down to 3%. This was the achievement we could do. But from 2011-12, subsequently, the NPA level has again gone up. Now, again, the legacy issues are very, very much legacy issues are there. Now, at that time, what is the major handicap in the NPA is that today in the entire country, today I can take an hypothecation, stocks against hypothecation from you as a banker in a PSU bank. Suppose I take 10 lakh rupees CC against hypothecation. Tomorrow I can very well say I have lost that my business. I had definite loss in my bank. So I have lost all my stocks. Now bank will have to only file a suit, summary suit. If it does not have a collateral security, if it does not have any other security, personal guarantee, then bank can only file a summary suit. And it is not treated as a 420. It's not treated as a fraud done on the bank. This kind of liberalization has been given by in the PSU banks to all the businessmen. Now, unfortunately, many businessmen misused this in the past, so many people. There were so many frauds have come in the picture in the credit accounts. So these people make a fraud, make an account bad debts, and then they go to another bank, they can open another bank account and then take another limits from those banks. So these kind of things were also happening. These are all the legacy. These were happening among the PSU banks itself. And they in turn make that account also bad. There was no. So that is why the exchange of information and credit report systems have come. And so that means what I'm trying to say, the NPC, NPA happening in the bank is not a one-day affair. It's a legacy which has brought, because the laws were not appropriate time, the laws were not introduced by the government. Today we have introduced the bankruptcy laws. This bankruptcy law, had we introduced some 25 years back, possibly many, many NPA would not happen. You see, in places like Singapore, if you don't pay the bank borrowing, In 6 months time, you are put in a visit after notice, then you are put into the jail. It is happening in many countries. Now, second, come to the capitalization aspect which you are raising about. Now, capitalization, if you see today, right, because today capital support, either by way of a budgetary support or by way of other support, the government is required to give, right? Why? Because the 80% and above, the shares are owned by the government of the PSU banks. Since they are the owner, they have to capitalize, that is their incumbent duty, because they are the owners. And that is not only that, and naturally they provide it either by way of a capital. If they go to the market, because of the high stock of NPA, the bank shares are not welcome. No financial analyst will go for buying it, anything. So only way forward is to go to the government for help. But if you see, whether government has given extraordinarily substantial support, if you ask, I differ in the sense, till by the government of India, till date, to all these PSU banks put together, hardly maybe around $14 billion. And if you see, compare the China has given $127 billion for capitalization. You know, if you see USA itself gives a capitalization when there was bubble, when there was 2008 Lehman issues were there, when there was a substantial bubble were there, they had supported more than $100 billion. So it's a world over bank. Whenever banks are under problem, giving a capitalization is a function of a government, especially in this India, it's more specific. So I think that adequate capitalization is not so far given by the government to the PSU bank till this date. Still, they can, maybe there is a issues, maybe there may be for the government itself, but still it is not safe. Now, I am personally at this juncture, I feel, now with the advent of these IB, that is a bankruptcy law, now IBC, which has come, now I am sure that if they are able to appoint few more IBC decision-making authority at various parts of the country, not only one place, and if they make the mechanism of the IBC, that is bankruptcy law, very strong, very faster, and if they are able to reduce the Surface Act disposal very faster, these two things are very essential. I am sure the bank stock of NPA can come down. Already they are around 10 to 11% range in the net NPA. I am sure this money is recoverable. Third aspect of this NPA I have seen, if you see, in the bank, in the country, first there was a coal scam. In the coal scam, whatever the huge amount of auction which has been made were required to be cancelled by the Supreme Court. You see the case of telecom scam. In the telecom scam, the total fraud was in the order of 1,56,000 crore. We don't know the correct figure still, but CAG says so. Now that means entirely that has been stopped. Now what has happened? In the telecom or if you go into the electricity, in those areas, there also in bank funding, the National Bank PSU funding happened mostly in infrastructure areas. So in all these infrastructure funding, which PSU banks have done, whether it is steel, whether it is coal, whether it is in telecom, whether it is in electricity, all the four had got stuck up substantially. And that, because of this stuck up, the NPA stock has come substantially. If the nation is responsible for all these scams, why the bank has to get the bad name on NPA, especially PSU bank? Is it not the duty of the government to help the banks to clean all these balance sheet? Take the case of even in other banks, like say Sweden, they have made a separate bad bank. Many countries in the world have in Mauritius, they were called. They wanted to segregate between a good bank and bad bank. Sweden has already done it. Now, government in those countries, the government, that is the ruling party and the opposition party, both, they sit together, they agree jointly to create a bank, and no politics was brought in the picture. And accordingly, they were segregated. And all the other PSU banks, they were made as a good bank and bad banks were segregated. These things can also be thought over by our country. Then only these NPA legacy can be written off.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I agree with you. You mentioned about nationalization being essential. And because from class banking, we needed to move to mass banking.
Mass bank.
Yeah. I spent 5 years in rural areas, yeah. So I can vouch. Had it not been for the nationalized banks, yes, the rural areas would not have really, really progressed.
Yes, exactly.
Yes, for the NPAs, we need to, for the NPS, we need to have legal remedial measures into be brought so that the banks can recover the money. Yeah. You spoke about infrastructure funding, which is very, very relevant because it is only the nationalized banks who are funding to infrastructure. And these are long gestation period loans, which unless something happens, these will be NPA. So the government needs NPA. To help the banks.
That is
and
exactly.
Then also mentioned about capital to be infusion, capital infusion that other countries have done. Yes, quantitative easing and other things is required in our country too. Good bank and bad bank. Yes, there are talks going on for it. Let us hope it happens very, very soon. And you mentioned about mergers. Do you think in the present law, Bank of Maharashtra is not going to be merged in another bank? Do you feel in the next 1 year or in the near future that will happen?
I don't think Bank of Maharashtra will be merged. It's my personal view because if they thought that merger was important in a national bank, even in the first lot, Bank of Maharashtra would have been merged. Because if you see, out of the total, say 1700 branches of Maharashtra, Bank of Maharashtra, maybe about 1200, 1100 branches are in Maharashtra itself. So it's a very handmaiden into the hands of the government. So they could have very well merged it with any other bank where who wanted, any North Indian bank who wanted a very deep penetration in Maharashtra could have got it at cheap rate. Like say like Allahabad bank, they went with Indian bank, could have been, they could have ideally gone with the Maharashtra bank. So my personal study is Bank of Maharashtra is not a bank meant for a merger, right? That is sure. I don't think that even in the remaining banks, which is coming in the next years, they will not merge with Bank of Maharashtra. Secondly, the Bank of Maharashtra history we have to see. They are the bank, it is started with the notion of a small man bank. And secondly, they were started in 1935-36 by the, in those days, like Lokmanya Tilak and all these people were behind this kind of beginning the bank. Maharashtra Chamber of Commerce has started this bank. And thirdly, till government of Maharashtra is itself, they feel very, very, very happy about the Bank of Maharashtra till this day. They feel like it's like their government bank, as much as the feeling I can see, because I worked as a, I was the in charge of the government of Maharashtra business also in those days. And secondly, at the state level, SLBC also, I was a secretary of the SLBC for a few years. So I have that idea and pulse. When I met those days, chief minister, maybe it's Congress, maybe it's any other BJP, any other party, irrespective of the party affiliation, maybe today Shiv Sena, irrespective of party affiliation, they feel Bank of Maharashtra as theirs. So there is no personal differences between any of the political party as far as Bank of Maharashtra status is concerned. It is beyond politics. So I feel they will not allow this to be merged. They want that bank to identify and assist the bank. And second point, in Bank of Maharashtra has brought the lives of the Maharashtrian, of entire Maharashtra up. Many Maharashtrian businessmen were traditionally working class. They became a businessman and they came tops. And for which the contribution of Bank of Maharashtra has been extremely high. And third aspect in the Bank of Maharashtra is that it's a fit case for the last six quarters. Now it is making a profit. It's a profit-making entity. And now even the government of Maharashtra, I am told, that they are opening the entire salary account of all their government employees with Bank of Maharashtra. Recently. Now, if Bank of Maharashtra's salary accounts are procuring from government of Maharashtra, why government will open at this juncture to a bank which is about to merge with elsewhere? So that is also another indication there are no move. Huh? Maybe a move could be there as per the instruction from the Prime Minister's office, I was told, to reduce the shareholding from the existing level. Presently, the existing level of shareholding may be around 80%, 78-80% in Bank of Maharashtra of Government of India. Now, they would like to bring it down. Now, here the issue is, so long as they bring it down to the level of 51%, no issue. But at least they should hold that 51% shareholding so that the assistance which are being given to the people of Maharashtra can be given by these 1,100 branches without diluting any of the great service which they are doing at other places. Until I worked in 37, 38 years in this bank, I know the services of this bank has been very, very endearing. So I can say that it's if they merge it or they may make it privatized, then it is not going to be a plus point to anybody. See, for privatization, nobody, if the moment you go below 51%, the rule says that you should announce the VRS scheme, Golden Handshake scheme. Now, this kind of scheme will reduce the workforce. Now, because anybody who is a buyer would like the meatiness, would like to go, the deadwoods or old people go, so that they will say. So this may not be, this will disturb the entire employee morale, which is upbeat at this juncture. It is these employee morale, you know, which is for the last six quarters, they brought it into the profit and they supported the chairman and executive director of this bank in converting into the bank. They have supported. So naturally, when they are making profit, this is not the right time to privatize. This is what I personally feel.
Okay. Could be good points. So now let's move to customer service. When we compare the customer service of public sector banks with that of the private sector banks, they don't come out smiling. With customer facing staff not responsive to customer needs and not willing to go the extra yards, customer service continues to suffer. Isn't it training imparted to customer facing staff to be more responsive to customer needs?
Actually, I tell you, I segregate this question into three parts. Mm-hmm. Now, what is customer service? This is one. I go into the customer service, according to me, consists of three areas. The area number one is the facility customer gets by way of technology. This is area number one. The customer, because today's customer would like to do the banking sitting at home. So the mobile banking has become a biggest hit of the generation today. So mobile banking or internet banking, that is customer service based on technology. Second, the customer service based on loaning system. Anybody who is getting a loan, maybe a farmer, maybe an industrialist, maybe a trader, they're getting a loan. This is the second part of customer service. And third part of customer service is the counter customer service. Now, if you see, I analyze these three customer service because they are having a different perceptions. Now, as far as the technology is concerned, today, if you compare the technology of HDFC Bank or ICICI Bank or Kotak Bank with the technology of the thing in the say about 10 years ago or 5 years ago, definitely these private sector banks are definitely superior than the PSU bank. Leaving the SBI, all the PSU banks will stand second vis-a-vis this private sector bank. Mainly because the computerization agreement of Rangarajan committee came late in 90s after the agreement. Subsequently, at that time, the NPS stock has gone up so high, the bank was not left with the money to invest in technology. This investing in technology, be it in hardware or software, were substantially costly. So they were to do very, very phase-wise. The employees who were traditionally, habituated with the manual, converting them to advanced ledger posting machine, as you call it, as a ALPM, and from ALPM to customer from the computer was not an easy point for a middle-aged person. It was very, very, very difficult. Now, subsequently, today it stabilized after great difficulty that got stabilized. Today, the technology may not be as superior like, say, RBS or like superior like HDFC. But all the same, the today's technology in nationalized PSU banks are no less inferior because they are now supported by TCS. Banks 24 is one thing. Today, if the nationalization has taken place, the merger has taken place in many PSU banks, many SBI group, which has happened mainly because many of them belonging to either Finacle or Banks 24 of TCS. Because of the TCS software, which is almost same today, so technology we have nearly come, though not exceeded. So the customer service has become really happy, especially if you see mobile banking. Those who have taken mobile banking, even in Bank of Maharashtra, I can say clearly, and of course some bank, funds loss has stopped. That is actually fraud has been because they have introduced in internet banking also one particular system by which it is not easy to defraud unless otherwise you share your OTP. Unless you don't share your OTP, no fraud can happen. So this has been avoided by the additional investment in the technology. Mobile banking has become very smooth. They have not, the new version has improved the mobile banking even in Bank of Maharashtra and many other PSU banks. Maybe it's still better in HDFC and ICICI. But still, it's all a process to compete with in few years down. So as far as technology is concerned, today remote access today the BCCA was having account with Bank of Maharashtra, and BCCA wanted remote access demand draft, and it was able to be provided by Bank of Maharashtra. So that means those advanced products which requires a specific intervention has been allowed, given by Bank of Maharashtra for such a big account, high value accounts. So again, it's all a high value. So technology, we are reasonably good now. Second, I come to the loans and systems of the customer service. I would say the loans and systems, leaving the corporate loan where we have suffered a lot of loss and leaving certain fraud, we were overall extremely happy about the all over India. You see, you go to the rural area, the level of the loan we give, maybe rural loans, especially if you go into the Kisan credit card, they have been very, very famous. The loan, which is many of them say, I have worked in Marathwada as a Marathwada area, that is Latur, Bid, Parbhani, Ingoli, as a zonal manager. I know the level of the, see, entire 90% of the exports of Draksha entirely were at the finance given by us. So many areas, it is now similarly, whether it is in Aurangabad or Solapur or Nasik, maybe a similar case of, there are cases where particular area is totally depending upon the assistance. So loaning point of view also, there are no complaints. Substantial 90%, 95% above employees are honest as far as loaning is concerned. There are bad apples. There will be bad apples in industry. I am not trying to defend them. But at the same time, mostly bank employees in Bank of Maharashtra, at least in PSU banks, I find them honest to the core as far as loaning patterns are concerned. The third aspect happens come to the customer service on counter. Now I am telling you, in the counter, there are two different perceptions. Now what is happening in a private sector bank service, customer service are superior, are apparently looking great than any of them. Not only because of the technology, mainly because if you go to any HDFC branch, bank branch, or if you go to any ICICI bank or Kotak bank, you find customers are standing orderly, very less. You go to the, say, if you go to the, say, our Bank of Maharashtra, Ghat Lodhia, or any other state bank branch, the moment you open a branch at 10 a.m., the shutter you open, it is like a first day, first show, cinema ticket, people will rush of the movie of, say, for example, Salman Khan movie, people will rush in. Even the queue has to go aside for opening. That kind of situation exists in the rural area. More often than not, after the Janadhan accounts are opened, the people who are making a lot of footfalls in rural area will also increase. So what happens, because of the multiplicity of the work, despite having an ATM outside the branches, despite passbook filling machines are kept in the branches, many customers still would like to have a passbook filled by their bank employees. There are these kind of extra queues are inside, and they all run in a area of say 1,000 square feet. If you can stand 1,000, if the 100 people can stand, then even all 500 people stand in that area, all sitting in few employees stand in the counter, then it becomes emotions rule high. There are problems. But there could happen, irritation level can happen, some bad apples happen. But out and out, if you secondly say, I would rate the customer service in PSU banks maybe at 80% level, 78 to 80% are good customer service. There is still weakness of 20%, but I cannot say maybe the 90% or 92% level may be good in HDFC or ICICI bank. That could be less. So customer service is not very bad, but there is a scope for improvement, I would say. One thing there, I come to your training point. There is the front office training is the most important in any organization. I have seen in Bank of Maharashtra, front office training were given in the local training colleges. But local training colleges, the respective bank inherent internal training colleges, what happens when you give training for more often, it is treated as a free lunch, a holiday from the working hour, working day. So that doesn't become a training. It's an entertainment time for the employees who come for a few days. That is not the way trainings are organized. So I am really feeling these employees, howsoever the bank should earmark few crores of rupees as an investment on training. They have to send them to the premier training institutes, which are there, or people who are well versed in a particular area. Suppose in Bombay, there is ABC companies are there, like they are providing good training. They have to be sent en bloc. This training has to be made as an investment, and it is a very, very important. The attitudinal change has to be brought. Even this has happened in 1980s in SBI. You will not be believing. If you see in 1980s, in State Bank of India, in those days, what happened? They were monolith bank. The UTI bank was only there. Even they were not converted. And subsequently, they were moving. In those days, if a customer goes to State Bank of India to deposit, say, 50,000 rupees, and if it doesn't bring the 100 rupee notes, instead, if he brought 10 rupee note packet or 5 packets, 10 packets out of this 1 lakh rupees, the cashier will throw it on his face. I will not accept. I will accept only 100s and 50. Those kind of restrictive practices were there with or without the employee's support, my employee union support. But those things have become a history. Now they are no more supported. Not even the trade union leaders are supporting today. They are not saying that. Trade union leaders are giving us, they are saying in the open meeting, which I myself heard, myself has uttered many times, they say there is no compromise on sincere counter work. That's a I should say 50 crore minimum should be earmarked in each bank for training purposes. This kind of high value budget only, right from the clerical Q level to the top general manager level, intensive training is needed even in. This can be extended to the, all these 1,600 branches of India. This is workable, yes. Solution.
Yes, I appreciate. Yes. Yeah.
Even if, I would say, even if it is not in a banking bank classroom, it can be put near, say, suppose if it is Pune, it can be put in Lonavala. If it is Bombay, you can put it in maybe a post-COVID, you can put it in near Raigad somewhere. So you can, that can be also organized. I should say money should not be the constraint.
Good. You have a wealth of knowledge at your disposal. How do you plan to channel it for benefit of society?
Whenever I'm called somewhere, I give lectures and give my viewpoint. And in fact, you know, Bank of Maharashtra Officers Union, they called me for the youngsters conference. The youth conference they organized. And I addressed around 2,000 officers of young officers. And I told them what is going to be banking in 2020, say. So in the next 2000, say 20, 30, 40s, I had given them, because entire future banking industry is going to undergo a lot of change with the advent of robotic, with the advent of artificial intelligence. Now with the advent of like Amazon Alexa coming into taking the banking activity, even Google, you know, Siri coming and taking the banking activity. There can be n number of, you know, bots and the activity can come. So I am saying there is going to be a technology war in the next 10, 20 years. Now, when I was, when I joined Bank of Maharashtra in 77, in 78, at that time, in 78, I was supposed to be one of the master in totaling in six columns. Thus, in those days, the current ledger, six column entry, it is to be total. I was a guy who used to total it, how much bigger the page with the pen. I needed to use a pencil. There was never a mistake. So I was feeling pride in myself, having a very good totaling. The advanced ledger posting machine came, my totaling knowledge became useless and became meaningless. So overnight, the talent which I had become low value. Similar thing can happen in banking. Today, whatever talent in bank officers can have, it will undergo a great change. They may become ineffective and inconsequential when the artificial intelligence and the robots come into the being in the banking hall. So it's a different ball game altogether. So these are the way I am trying to address the youngsters and trying to motivate them and giving them solution. This is one. Secondly, in future, I propose to write some book on my experiences. So which I am making an outline. I already made outline, which I may do. These are the two things. Thirdly, I am, of course, I am otherwise in the society.
Yeah, you mentioned about the expiry date of knowledge, which is very, very true. I was reading the other day. It said the expiry knowledge, expiry date of a knowledge is just 2.5 years. So whatever you learn now, within 2.5 years, it will become obsolete. So it's very, very imperative that the younger generation keep upskilling themselves to be relevant in society.
Exactly. That is where the senior banker like you or the guy who like you have written a lot of books will come into help. You know, I really feel.
I'm willing to make that sacrifice for society.
Oh, very nice. It will be a great pleasure. I really would like some days to join you to in helping them. In fact, already you are a professional speaker in India. So it's a great thing to know.
So now we'll go to the audience, and if they have any questions, let's field them.
Yeah.
Jaya, do we have any comments or questions? Can you read out, please?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So we had a few comments which said that very good session and everything, but we still don't have any questions. So let's wait up for somebody. If they need to ask something, they need to discuss something. You can also unmute yourself and ask a question to Mr. Bharat Kumar and we'll be here. Okay. So I have something
I
here.
I received a comment.
Yeah.
I received a Sundar comment Shekhar. Here. One of Sundar Shekhar. All the best for writing though. Thank you, Sandra.
He says all the best in your new venture of writing books with your great expertise.
Yeah.
Now that's something great. Great. So it was amazing to hear you, sir. A lot of experience that you have, and more than anything, your energy is like, oh my God, it's like a atom bomb energy. So it kept us also kind of going in with you. So I'm sure people might be, almost trying to absorb whatever they heard from you and, you know, trying to understand, okay, what more do we ask now? There was quite a bulletin.
I hope I'm not fast. I'm not very fast.
No.
I hope.
Not at all. You were perfect.
I was audible.
You were extremely energetic and, you know, that it's fun to hear somebody who's so energetic because then even that
Thank
keeps
you.
Us, you know, in the group. So, yes.
Hello.
So,
You have boosted my...
Hello.
Hi.
Prem?
Yes.
Yeah, one or two small questions.
Yes, Suresh, go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to ask, sir, that what is his take on the present PMC bank? Because we have talked about various measures which are required to be taken by the government and they should do this and that. Under the government knows we are allowed these people to run away and PMC depositors are facing the crux. So that is one small question. Second point is that now State Bank has announced some 20,000-30,000 people are taking VRS. So
yeah.
Will other banks also like to follow in this particular measure?
Yeah. See, I would like to answer as far as PMC is concerned. You know, what has happened to the depositors of PMC was extremely atrocious. And you know, there is no words to mention about how much, you know, misery they were required to put because when anybody sees a name bank, they are naturally gullible to keep money in that. It's not that it's not a small bank as such. PMC was once upon a time reputed bank. Now I am sure RBI had taken a measure and today even government is though not quick enough, alacrity level may be less. But today I still feel that PMC bank, every penny will be paid to the government. Though they say that there is no deposit insurance corporation and all, but I am not expecting the government to put a, you know, soft footing on the defaulters. Those owners will be brought to book. They will face the law. I am sure about it. The law takes its course. Even Nirav Modi or whether Malaya, they run away from the country. Despite the fact that the Prime Minister meeting the talk to the Prime Minister of England doesn't happen to bring the Modi back. They have to go by the rigors of the law, which takes a lot of time. Similar is the way these PMC people are now dodging the system. but again I'm sure people will suffer, but they will get all their money. I'm sure about it. As far as if you say about today, State Bank of India, 13,000 BRS. Now I tell you, that has been clarified by the MD, CMD, CEO of the State Bank. No, VRS is only a, what you call is a on-tap VRS. It's not like gold and handshake. You know, in State Bank of India, the VRS is announced, it's a new form of HR management which they are talking. Whether it is correct or wrong is different, only time will tell. As of today, they call it as an on-tap VRS. On-tap VRS means, today I want to appoint a new 14,000 people I want to recruit as a State Bank of India. But as again, these 14,000 people which I want to recruit, I want to give VRS to 14,000 people of the bank on willingness basis. See, people do happen. People, some of the people do have some issues. Suppose I am, if you are transferring me from, say, Ahmedabad, I am today, you are transferring me to Calcutta. It is not comfortable to me when my age is 55. I have so many people to support. So I personally feel, or sometimes those who are above 55, under the pension rules, if you complete 28 years of completed service, you are entitled to get full pension. So I personally feel that why should I continue with the bank when I am getting a full pension? Maybe marginally I may lose money. So let me give a VRS. I don't want to go on transfer to Calcutta. So I take a decision on VRS in my own personal reasons. So it is called as an on-tap VRS. So it's more of a convenience, but it is not adverse so long as the recruitment is not stopped. So it is a win-win situation for State Bank of India, because the person who is having a 55 years of age, he is having a salary level, he is at the stagnation level increment he must be getting, he is at the peak of the pay scale. Whereas the person who is appointed newly will be at the first stage of the pay scale. So bank is also saving the wages. Still getting the bank gets the youngster and make the older people to go elsewhere. That's why. I hope I answered you.
Thank you.
Sir, Bharat.
Hi, Venkata.
Bharat Kumar, sir. Very nice to hear your energetic speech like Jaya told.
Thank you.
Incidentally, I am also a banker. I am from State Bank of India. I worked in State Bank for 20 years. I joined in 1982 as a probation officer.
Wow.
And then I took exit option in the year 2007 after completing 20 years. Currently, I draw pension from State Bank of India. So my question to you is, people like you are, you're like, I would say, the backbone of any bank. And in State Bank also, I've seen many hundreds of people like you who have contributed a lot and then who have got tremendous potential to make the bank grow very well. But for various reasons, all such people have left. And in the, even in this 30,000, whatever, whoever is going to leave, definitely such kind of cream will go away, means mass amnesia is likely to set in. See, youngsters are okay. They take less salary, cost of staff will come down. But then that doesn't mean, I mean, the rich experience of people like you and the kind of energy that you have, that means you have passion to serve the country through the bank. I mean, such kind of breed has become a vanishing species. It is becoming extinct, which will have dire consequences for the health of the bank as well as the health of the country itself. Because banks are the heartbeat of the country. So, what's your comment about it?
My perception is that bank, if at all any energetic people at the higher levels of management, if they are quitting under VRS, which is this 30,000 VRS which they are announcing, I personally feel that the bank top management will not let them go. They will convince them. See, even it has happened in many banks. The top management, whether it is ED or chairman, they speak to those DGM, GM, AGMs and request them not to leave. And many people, they have withdrawn their plan because of that. Again, what happens in a 90%, if that happens, that is a good AR process, HR process. But if it doesn't happen, that shows some malady in the HR process of a particular bank, if that is not there. But I personally feel the existing top management is BI. Are so matured enough, I don't think, you see, the Mr. Ranjit Kumar was the past MD of this bank, you know. He was the guy who was responsible for increasing the family pension by talking to the finance minister himself personally. Such kind of attitude are there in the top management, like MD and SBI at that level. So I have to only appreciate, I have confidence in SBI management. They will not leave the talents to go. They will allow people who are suffering to go. That's what I feel.
Let's hope for the best.
Yes. Very nice, Dangara. Seeing meeting an SBI officer is very pleasurable to me. I'm very happy.
I have something
today,
from
SBI is a top bearer in the PSU bank. Yeah, Jaya.
We have something from A.S. Patil. He says, a very nice informative session as our BOM is concerned, because I am a retire from Bank of Maharashtra. Thanks, Bharat Kumar Sahib, Prem Raj and Jaya for arranging the same. Thank you, Mr. Patil, for acknowledging that.
Thank you. Thanks for his praise. Convey my thanks to him.
Okay, if anyone... If there might be anybody who wants to ask something, you can unmute and ask, or else we will wind up the session and we'll catch up again tomorrow at the same time. All right. Mr. Bharat Kumar, before leaving, would you like to say something to the viewers today?
Yeah, I want to end my statement with one statement. I have a very strong feeling that the banking industry is going to explode in the next 10 years, because in my very strongly I'm having a feeling that in the next 10 years down the line, by 2030, the rural masses are going to be technology, fintech companies are, so many fintech companies are coming in the picture. More the Google and Amazon and similar companies are also trying to tap our rural market. Hitherto, the private sector banks like HDFC, ICICI, who are only making the rural advances being bought for achieving their priority sector target. Now, they are also understanding the rural area strength, and they will be also using the technology in the rural areas. So, I personally feel with the opening of Jandan accounts, now funding the Jandan accounts of 100 crore people is the next target to all these people. So, when the funding is going to happen to them, what will happen is that all the rural money lenders will vanish and all these banks will substitute in place of these money lenders. So it will help the rural masses, plus at the same time it will help the banks themselves in profitability. Consequently, it will improve in your Sensex numbers. That's what I was saying. If your Sensex becomes 50,000 to 60,000 number, don't be surprised in the next 10 years time. This is the last thing. Thank you. We are there. I wish people like us should be there to see all these things and be happy. To support in any way this management want.
That is so nice of you to be saying that. Thank you so much. So Prem Raj ji, what is it that you would like to say before we wind up?
Yeah. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Your energy is infectious. It was a pleasure listening to the pearls of wisdom from you. Our knowledge and understanding of banking has been enriched after our interaction. Wishing you good health and happiness. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Prem Raj. You honored me by calling me in this meet, and wish you all the success in your endeavors.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prem Raj ji, Bharat Kumar ji, and each one of you for joining in, being here with us, being so interactive, asking us some valuable questions, which has generated a lot of great conversation here. So we look forward to many more such sessions. And Bharat Kumar ji, thank you for that energy and that information and so much love that you showered on us. We look forward to having you once again whenever soon. Prem Raj, thank you. I am getting to learn so much with these series and the kind of speakers that you're bringing in. I cannot thank you enough. Thank you so much. Thank you each of the participants that have stayed with us all along. And have been with us, interacting with us. Thank you so much. It means a lot. And we will meet again tomorrow with yet another speaker. And that's going to be again something interesting because we have Hetal with us. She is a member and she is a nutritionist. So if you're looking at some kind of good health stuff, please be there tomorrow too. So thank you so much. Signing off from here and we catch up tomorrow again. Thank you.
Jaya. Thank you, Premraj.
Thank you.
You made my day.
Thank you. You made our day.
Thank you, Ramchandran.
Thank you.